Could one of America's best allies be a training ground for terrorists?
Britain is now a major exporter of terrorists. Today, Britain has functioning Sharia courts, and Sharia patrols enforce Islamic law on some of its streets.
The rise of British jihadists, and why some say they're coming to America, on today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Well, welcome to the show. The headlines are grim. Journalists are being beheaded. Christians are being slaughtered. Extremists are on the move. And they have the West in their sights.
In Britain, Muslims have taken over some parts of the country. Now, a group of British Christians are fighting back. They're passing out Bibles, even in mosques. Dale Hurd has the story from London.
No one who has been paying attention to the growth of radical Islam in Britain should have been surprised that the terrorist who stood over murdered American journalist James Foley was reported to have a London accent. Over 1,000 British Muslims are now fighting for the Islamic State, and more are joining every day.
The key thing to realize about British fighters in Syria is that they're not there to take a backseat role. They are very much at the forefront of this conflict.
Britain is now a major exporter of terrorists, the result of multiculturalism. There have been warning signs for years. This was a Muslim protest in London CBN News brought to viewers more than 8 years ago. Today, Britain has functioning Sharia courts, and Sharia patrols enforce Islamic law on some of its streets.
Remove yourself away from the mosque. Go away from the mosque now. Muslim patrol.
It's a Muslim area, and you're not wanted around here.
Islamic halal food is everywhere, and Islam is today the fastest growing religion in the UK.
I actually gave up a modeling career for Islam, and that's the best choice I've made ever.
Even though Muslims are a relatively small minority in Britain, there is a feeling among some British that their nation is being handed over to Islam, that the government doesn't care about promoting traditional British values, Judeo-Christian values, either because it doesn't believe in them anymore or because it doesn't want to be labeled as intolerant. British civilization has been a gift to the world. But the British don't care so much about their own civilization anymore, and it's into this vacuum that Islam is advancing. Sure, the British still care about their queen and tradition, but radical Muslims have been allowed and even encouraged to build a parallel society within this officially Christian nation.
The reason we have capitulated in the West so much to Islam is self-hatred. There's an underlying self-hatred of our own societies, of our own cultures.
Anne-Marie Waters is a former leftist who runs Sharia Watch UK.
We've got this multiculturalism, this dangerous multiculturalism in Britain, which is killing women, killing girls. And the left not only doesn't say anything about it, but continues to push for it as a good, even though it knows, even though it can see that it's killing girls. We know for a fact that there are mosques in this country where little girls of 8, 9, 10 years of age are being married, quote-unquote married, to older men, and being raped.
When British soldier Lee Rigby was decapitated in the streets of London, one of the first things Prime Minister David Cameron said was that the murder was not because of Islam. After the Foley decapitation, Cameron said it again. And to be sure, many British Muslims have condemned the murder.
As a Muslim, you know, I feel we shouldn't do it.
I think it's disgusting. I think that a lot of extremists have taken over and hijacked Islam.
We come back to this, it's only a tiny minority of extremists, it's got nothing to do with Islam, but the point is, this stuff is coming directly from the Quran, from the Hadith.
Muslim immigrant sex grooming gangs were covered up by the British police for 20 years. The British government's weak response to radical Islam has led to the formation of citizen groups and protest movements, like the English Defense League and Britain First. Britain First goes into the street to confront Sharia patrols and has horrified the British establishment for having the nerve to go into mosque to pass out Bibles to Muslims.
And now, there's a nice British Army Bible. Spread the word of Jesus Christ around Bradford. Amen. Jesus Christ our Lord. We want to save you from hell. We reject the false prophet Muhammad and read the Bible.
The chairman of Britain First is Paul Golding.
This is a Christian country. Our heritage is Christian. We take it very seriously. We hold it dear. So giving out Christian Bibles in a Christian country on British streets to people who are British citizens, we don't see anything wrong with that. Have you looked around for any threats at all?
But when we were with Golding, he was dodging the police, who seemed to view him as a troublemaker. The British government is going to have to decide whether it cares more about being viewed as tolerant or about stopping terrorism, because the whole world is now paying the bill for Britain's experiment in multiculturalism.
And we have got to start dealing with this. We've got to say, look, we have freedom of speech. You can't beat up women. We won't stone people to death for their sex lives. You have to accept that or you can't live here.
Dale Hurd, CBN News, London.
Our CBN News terrorism analyst, Eric Stackelback, is here with us. Eric, thanks for joining us.
Gordon, great to be with you.
Well, Britain just raised the terror threat to severe and is also trying to say now we want to fight radicalism there and abroad. Is that enough? Do you think this is enough to stop this?
Gordon, my big worry about Britain is this may be too little too late. If you remember, what, 9 years ago, the 7/7 bombing, July 7, 2005, where over 50 Brits were killed in these multiple subway and bus bombings in London, Tony Blair, then British Prime Minister, said, hey, we're going to get tough on extremism now. This is it. We're taking on the radicals. Well, this is 9 years later, and the threat today, I would argue, Gordon, is even worse in Britain than it was in 2005. The Brits have done nothing to stop the massive flow of Muslim immigration. Immigration's one thing, but the Muslims who are coming to Britain in large numbers, and Gordon, I've been there on the ground. I've seen it with my own two eyes. I've interviewed radical imams in London. We've seen it on CBN News, they're not assimilating. And as Dale said in his piece, they are forming parallel societies. Even in East London, in the shadow of London's financial district, I have walked the streets. I have seen buildings, literally, Gordon, that have signs outside that say Sharia Court. It may be too far down the road right now for Britain to really get a handle on this.
Well, it's almost like they were asleep at the switch. I mean, why would you allow a separate culture to form that's intent on changing you? You know, we've even heard of the joke, they're trying to make it London stand. Why would they allow that to continue?
You know, Gordon, this goes back to the 1980s, if you can believe it. Now, back in the 80s, and I've talked to terrorism experts, analysts in London who have laid this out for me. Back in the 1980s, the British government basically made a deal with the devil where they let all of these asylum seekers from places like Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Syria, guys who were wanted for terrorism in their home countries, the Brits allowed them to relocate to Great Britain and to set up shop. And what they had, Gordon, was basically an unspoken agreement. If you don't strike us here on British soil, we'll let you live here. Well, that all changed, obviously, on 7/7, 9 years ago with the bombings then. And today, it's almost like a game of whack-a-mole, Gordon, where the Brits nearly every day are breaking up a new terror plot, and the next day, another one emerges. Why they let this happen is beyond me. I can tell you that Great Britain, there is a rampant political correctness there, number one. Number two, Christianity in Great Britain, which is a place, Gordon, as you know, where the gospel went out for years. Christianity in Britain has been severely weakened, and I can tell you the waves of Muslim immigrants who are coming to Britain's shores have religious zeal, a clear goal, and a clear ideology. They know exactly what they want and exactly what they're fighting for, and that is Sharia law in the UK.
Well, let's turn our attention to America now. Two of the ISIS fighters, to my amazement, were from Minnesota. Are we becoming the new Britain here? Are we becoming a new pocket for radical Islam?
There's a great chance of that. And Gordon, I look to Britain and I look to Europe as almost a harbinger, a cautionary tale of what could come here to the United States. We see a few things that remind me of the situation in Britain. Number one, we have the growth of mosques in the United States, and not just mosques, but radical mosques with a radical ideology and radical imams. I've been in these mosques, Gordon. I've reported for them on CBN News. It's a dangerous thing. Number two, we have areas in the United States, in Chicago, Dearborn, Michigan, New York City, where large Muslim immigrant communities are setting up almost parallel societies, like we saw in Great Britain. That's a major concern of mine. And the radicalization, which you just mentioned in Minnesota, at least a dozen residents of the Twin Cities areas, this is the Midwest of the United States, have traveled to Syria to join ISIS. Even worse than that, Gordon, dozens and dozens of Somali immigrants in Minneapolis. People might not realize Minneapolis, of all places, has the largest Somali Muslim population in the United States. Dozens of young Somalis have traveled back home to Somalia to join Al-Qaeda-linked groups there. And here's the rub, Gordon. They are going to return home one day. That's the problem. These are U.S. citizens, U.S. passport holders. One day after they're done training and battling with Al-Qaeda, ISIS, they're going to come back here. And when they come back, they're not going to go back to school and get their bachelor's degree or get a job at a gas station. They're going to come back here and they're going to set up cells. That's what they will be directed to do and trained to do by the likes of Al-Qaeda and ISIS. And my fear is eventually it's going to bite us here.
What is it about Islam that creates this? You don't hear about United Methodist Jihad, but here you see, and it seems to morph, and whether you call it Muslim Brotherhood or ISIS or Al-Qaeda, it seems to morph and literally sprout up this kind of terror activity on its own. What is it about Islam that does this?
I think there's a few things, Gordon. I think, number one, the Quran and the Hadiths, Islam's core texts, like it or not, are littered with calls to violence. That's indisputable. Muslims will tell you, yes, there are very violent verses in the Quran, but look, they were just meant for the 7th century. They were meant for Muhammad's day. They're not applicable today. Well, guess what? The majority of Muslims in the world today believe that those calls to jihad are open-ended and that they are applicable today. Number two, I think the example of Muhammad. Muhammad himself, and Muslims will tell you this, was a warrior, was a political leader, was a conqueror. That's indisputable. Number three, the history of Islam, both current and older, is a history of conquest by the sword. These are indisputable facts. So I think when you combine all those things, you have the situation that we have today. But I think at the end of the day, the radicals, the jihadists, they can point to the Quran and the Hadiths, and they have a very compelling theological case that what they're doing is what Islam calls them to do.
We're coming up on the anniversary of 9/11, and I keep hearing there's a lot of chatter out there. I keep hearing that they're missing commercial airliners. What are you hearing?
I'm hearing the same thing. And one thing I'm hearing, Gordon, remember Al-Qaeda? Remember the guys who struck us on 9/11? They've been overshadowed recently by ISIS. Well, Al-Qaeda wants to get back in the game. There's kind of a competition right now going on between Al-Qaeda and ISIS for especially young recruits. Now, in the world of jihad, Gordon, it's a kind of a what have you done for me lately kind of world. Well, Al-Qaeda hasn't done all that much lately. ISIS is conquering vast amounts of territory in the heart of the Middle East. Al-Qaeda's been mainly silent. There's a concern that Al-Qaeda, because of that, is going to try to make a splash and become relevant again. Now, Al-Qaeda has an official glossy magazine, and in the recent issue, Gordon, they levied threats against Las Vegas and against military targets here in the U.S. So, number one, there's absolutely an eye on Al-Qaeda, what they're going to do. And number two, ISIS, Al-Qaeda, all jihadists have threatened U.S. embassies and consulates around the world. Remember Benghazi, the other 9/11 anniversary, September 11, 2012, when our consulate in Benghazi was sacked by Islamic terrorists, our ambassador killed. That is another threat. And number three, Gordon, that porous southern border is a major concern for U.S. intelligence. And a big concern is that the likes of ISIS will utilize that border. It is wide open and enter the U.S. and set up a cell here to strike.
Well, lots of reasons to stay awake at night and pray for the protection of America. If you want to know more on this subject, make sure to watch Eric's television show. It's called The Watchman. It's available through CBNNews.com. His latest book is called The Brotherhood, which is available in stores nationwide. Eric, thank you for being with us, and thank you for all you do to keep us aware of these things.
Thank you, Gordon.
If you want to know about more on Islam and why does Islam promote terror, what is it about this religion that causes this kind of activity in its followers? We've got something for you. It's called Islam, Religion of Peace or War. And let me underline something that's in this booklet. You find it on pages 19 and 20. It's from the Quran itself, Surah 47. It's a clear underpinning for the 21st century beheadings that have shocked us all. Here's a direct quote from the Quran. When you meet those who misbelieve, non-Muslims, while fighting in jihad, cut off their heads until you have massacred them. They have a direct commandment. That's a commandment from the Quran to do this kind of activity. That's why we're seeing it. And in Islam, in this radical Islam, it's considered the greatest form of death that you can do to a non-believer in the middle of jihad. That's why they do it. That's why they stage it. That's why they video it. It's because their religion commands it. If you want to get more information, it's available for you. All you have to do is call us, 888-777-1999. You can also log on to CBN.com and you can download it now. Get informed, because we need to be informed about what's going on in the world today. We don't need to, you know, put this under the rug and say, well, not all Muslims do this. That's true. But what is it about Islam that causes Muslims to do this kind of atrocious act? It's written right in the book that they say they believe in.
And, you know, the perfect storm in this, Gordon, seems to be that we have followed the same route as Great Britain in losing our own identity as a nation, spiritually and in some ways on other levels as well, so that tolerance, the whole concept of tolerance has really changed the whole premise for all of this. You know, it's like it's opened a door to things that we wouldn't have said.
Well, there were a whole series of ideas that came up that we're essentially, how do we self-criticize ourselves? That, you know, we have a lot of ideals, and we're not matching those ideals. And that was true, and that was a good exercise. But in the process of doing that, did we undercut the very foundation of our culture?
Yeah, I think so.
And in the piece we saw at the start of the show, one of the reasons advanced as to why Britain did it is that there was self-loathing, that they didn't appreciate their own culture. And if you don't go back in history and realize a lot of that culture, there were very good reasons for it, and that foundation is sure, and that's what's caused the flowering of civilization in the Western world. There's radical differences between life in America, life in Great Britain, and life in the Middle East. Mm-hmm. And if you don't appreciate the fountain, if you will, of democracy, all the freedoms that we have are based on our Judeo-Christian heritage.
Exactly.
And if we don't honor that and stand for that, and literally stand up, we've got to be able to stand up and say, your ideas about God are wrong. Mm-hmm. If you think you die killing innocents, you're going to go straight to heaven, you're wrong. If you think the highest way to worship your God is to cut off somebody else's head, you're wrong. But we don't seem to have the fortitude to say that is, there's black and white here. Your concepts are wrong, and we need to forcefully move that agenda so that people wake up.
To say this is who we are, and you are welcome to come here to become part of what we are, but not to establish your own.
Yeah, we're a melting pot.
Yeah, I mean, we are a melting pot, but we're America. And if you want to come here, you become an American. I mean, that's just the bottom line to me. Well, coming up, a terrorist who entered the United States bent on jihad. Find out what stopped him. That's coming up next.
The tests are really difficult.
It's that time of year again.
The homework.
When thousands of students return to the classroom.
When I get picked on, it's it's always hurting me. And the other people feel good, but it's hurting me.
Surviving back to school on the next 700 Club Interactive. Hamas Salim was born in Lebanon and raised to become a terrorist. His mission was to undermine America from the inside.
48% of the Muslim in the United States of America believe that they are Muslim first, they are American second. Our purpose is to change this culture because they're infidel and what they're doing is not pleasing to Allah, and we are the soldier of Allah who will make them do it.
Kamal Salim was born in Lebanon to a devout Muslim family. As early as 4 years old, he remembers sitting at the kitchen table while his mother taught him about the Quran and his duty to Allah and jihad.
From my childhood, my mom said, "One day you'll be a martyr, my son. You will die for the sake of Allah and you will exalt Islam." She said, "If you kill a Jew, my son, your hand will light up before the throne of Allah and the host of heaven will celebrate what you have done."
Kamal was seven when his parents sent him to Muslim training camps to learn to use weapons and engage and kill the enemy. The boys were also taught another, more subtle form of warfare.
We were training for what's called culture jihad, which is shifting cultures. Culture jihad is, it's unlike the sword, unlike the rifle, it is the jihad that will come into your world.
By his 20s, Kamal was chosen to wage cultural jihad on America.
In Islam, liberty, freedom, monarchy, all these are idols and these must be brought down. So the liberty that you have in the United States of America, it's anti-Islam, you know, so America must be changed. So I moved to the Bible Belt specifically. The Bible Belt was the strongest of strongest. That's where the stout Christians are. And I want to take on the best of the best because I considered myself as a sword of Islam. I thought I'm anointed, I'm unique, I'm selected. I'm coming to a country and a culture to change it, and I have the power of Allah with me.
In the early 1980s, Kamal entrenched himself in a small Midwestern town. He began targeting men from poor neighborhoods to recruit them to the Muslim faith. But one afternoon, his life would be in the hands of those he hated the most.
I was going from one place to another to do a recruitment, and that day I had a car wreck. The car wreck was so severe, I ejected out of my car, landed on my neck, broke my neck in two places. This man came running to me, and he said, "Don't worry, we're gonna take care of you, and everything's gonna be all right." The ambulance came and picked me up. And now I go to the hospital, the orthopedic surgeon in the emergency room looked at my chart and he just said, "Son, we are going to take care of you and everything's gonna be all right." The second day I wake up in the hospital and this head of physical therapy come and read my chart. And he turned around and he said the same thing word for word, "We are going to take care of you."
At first, Kamal was frightened by their words because these men were all Christians.
You see, in terrorism, if they said, "We're gonna take care of you," you'd better run.
Surgeries to repair Kamal's broken neck were successful, but recovery would take weeks. After being discharged from the hospital, he would need someone to care for him while he recuperated. Kamal had no one. So the orthopedic surgeon opened up his own home to this stranger.
In his home, they put me in the choicest room, in the most beautiful thing. I became like part of their family. They didn't see me any different. And now they have a basket set for Kamal. They put in money to free my bills from the hospital.
Kamal was overwhelmed with the outpouring of Christian love. As he recovered, he began to help out around the house with cooking and cleaning.
They have Jewish friends, they came from Israel, that they support, you know. And now I'm hugging Israelis and I'm cooking for Jews. I'm going, "What has happened to me?"
When Kamal was able to take care of himself and return to his apartment, the doctor had another surprise for him.
He said, "This is the keys to the house, and here's an extra key. This is your new car. We just want to bless you. You can come anytime you want." So I go to my home, and I go to my cold place that I haven't been there in months, and dust is this thick. And I just gotta settle this issue with my God to know that if it's real or not. So I walk inside, I shut the door, I go right in the eastern window and I fall on my knees and I put my hands to the heavens and I cry up to my God. Allah, Allah, my Lord and my King, why have you done such a thing to me? I'm okay with the car wreck. I'm okay with all this, but why did you put me among Christians? I'm confused. These Christians and Jews, they're good people. There's nothing wrong with them. They don't want to kill us. They're not the same thing that I learned about them. Allah, these people have relationship with their God. These people, they cry out to the God and they answer them. I want to hear your voice. I want to hear you love me. If you're real, speak to me. I want to hear your voice. Guess what Allah said that day? Absolutely nothing.
Kamal felt that because he questioned his faith, the honorable thing to do was to end his own life.
So I went to reach out my guns and put it in the right place and clock out. I heard the voice. The voice knew me by name. He said, Kamal, 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 why don't you call on God of Father Abraham and Isaac and Jacob? And now I fell on my knees and I put my hands to the heavens immediately as I heard the voice, and I cried out with every fiber within me, God the Father Abraham, if you are real, would you speak to me? God the Father Abraham, if you are real, I want to know you. Well, God of Father Abraham came to the room, and he filled the room with his glory, and his name was Yahweh, the Lord is one. In his hand, he has holes in his hand, he has holes in his feet. His name is Jesus. I said to him, who are you, my Lord? Who are you? He said, I am that I am. I said, I'm a simple man with a simple mind. What is that supposed to mean? He said, I am the Alpha, I am the Omega, I am the beginning, I am the end, I am everything that is in between. I have known you before I formed the foundation of the earth. I have loved you before I formed you in your mother womb. Rise up, come on. Kum, you are my warrior, you are not their warrior. And I said to him, I said, my Lord, I will live and die for you. He said, do not die for me. I died for you that you may live.
That day, instead of taking his life, Kamal gave it to Jesus. He now has a new mission and travels the country challenging Muslims to question their allegiance to Allah.
My heart desire is to reach out for my brothers and sisters, the Muslim out there, 1.5 billion Muslim, that they are living out there and they have not tasted the freedom and that freedom in God.
It's been over 20 years since Kamal left the Islamic faith, and even threats of violence and death cannot stop him from sharing his story.
He is real, you know, and if you never experienced God before in your life, if you never tasted God, and if you think you got nothing to lose, when you're sitting in your home, whether you're a Muslim or a non-Muslim or a non-Christian or whatever you are, say, call on God of Father Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and say, if you are real, speak to me, I want to hear your voice.
Take that challenge. Take it today. Don't let another day go by where you don't know him. When you find him, you find the answer to every human need. You find purpose. You find love. You find unconditional acceptance. You find what you were made to do. You find it all. You don't have to wonder anymore. You don't have to live a life, what am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to believe? And he makes it very simple for you. Anyone who comes to me, anyone, whosoever, that's you, he'll show up for you. He promises that he'll manifest himself to you. What do you have to do? You just have to ask. So take the challenge, and here's the prayer for you. Jesus, if you're real, if you really came to save me, if you really came to forgive me, if you really want me to know you, could you show me? And if you pray that with all of your heart, he'll answer. He'll show up for you. If you want help with that prayer, we're here for you. All you have to do is call us, 888 777 1999. We leave you with Psalm 91. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High God shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty.